So, Narisha, you're ready for the last talk of the day?
Oh, yes.
So you'll be favoring composition the groovy way. I'm looking forward to hearing that. I'll get off the stage and leave it to you. Go ahead.
Well, thanks, Soren. Welcome, everyone, to the talk, Favoring Composition, the Groovy Way. Let's find out what does Groovy offer, us to favor composition rather than sticking to inheritance. My name is Naresha, and let's start with the object-oriented maturity model. That might sound very scary, but it's just my little way of conveying typically how developer evolves through using an object-oriented language. So let's start. Since we are developers, we start with the zero rather than one. So level zero, mostly procedural code and not much inheritance, unless imposed by frameworks. So that's where level zero. Then people find out that there's golden hammer in object-oriented language. That's inheritance. And people learn the reuse. So we can reuse something available in another class through inheritance. For example, maybe one of the widely misquoted example would be like using 3D extending from 2D because there are something for reuse. People start doing this, which it's not good, but yeah, that's where people reach level one, which is like use inheritance as much as possible in the name of reuse. Then people discover, okay, that's not how inheritance supposed to be used. There is something called Liskov substitution principle, wherein essentially to implement this polymorphic behavior. You use inheritance, that is the child objects can be substituted for the objects of parent class or the parent contract. That's where that's the right way to use inheritance. So with that, once people understand that, people use way less inheritance and start favoring composition. So we have heard this several times. Generally, say in the object-oriented design perspective, we have this mentioned in Gang of Four book, right? Way long ago, and it talks about favor object composition instead of class inheritance. Then again, if you want something very specific to Java, again this is mentioned in Effective Java book, but in spite of all these advices, the reality when we see in projects mostly is this, right? The difference between theory and practice is in theory somewhat smaller than in practice. Also, we say, okay, we perfectly agree that we have to prefer composition, but isn't inheritance easy to implement? That's what people tell when they use inheritance. So again, let's start with an example. Say we have four numbers. I start with an array list. I set some string values into that. And suppose, say I want to perform some map operation, prefixing all the numbers to get with the certain format, starting with plus. Then I want to find some number. Then say I want to filter all the four numbers belonging to US, then that will fail because there is no such method available in array list. At this point, okay, I want to create a type which has that method. The first thing comes to mind is extending from array list, so that all I have to do is just create the new method. All other methods will be available which are already defined in array list. Let's just reuse them. But then we know that's not the right thing to do. Okay, this all works now with the array list. Let's say for a moment, let's consider using composition. So what will I need to do, right? We start with, of course, array list instance that holds the data. Then finally, I just implement the methods that I'm using here, not all the methods from list. So I used find, I used collect. Then the plus was used for, adding values. And finally, this is the, US phone numbers is the custom method for which I needed a new type altogether. So compare this with the, usual extending a class, which looks fairly easy. So that's the main reason why people, don't use composition in many places. Now let's say what Groovy has to offer here. So, and again, all I'm doing here is create a placeholder for the state that holds the data. Here it's a list of string, and you apply the delegate AST transformation, and you're ready with the composition. So composition design is no more harder, doesn't take any extra code than inheritance, and all the methods were so expected. So that's the use of delegate. That is the first technique what helps us to favor composition. So let's start with this. So we say we have a class bird. So you have a bird which is a pet. You named it as Sunny, and bird can fly. And also we have an instance of butterfly, right? Obviously you may not be naming your butterfly. So you might want to use something like, okay, a butterfly, create an instance and it can fly too. Of course, you could see there is some common contract here, right? Both of them have method fly. So let's make sure we have an interface flyable. Then I can create a list of that and add values. I can call the fly method on or any type that has a fly method, or in other case, if we have an explicit interface, okay, it's a flyable interface. Now let's see how we can implement that. So let's start with the very typical Java style. You can implement the interface, and the implementation looks pretty similar here. So it would look like we are violating the DRY principle here. I have put it as a potential violation of DRY principle, because duplicate code always may not be violation of DRY principle, right? Sometimes it just happens that they have the same values at that point in time, or code is same, but they may not always be violating DRY principle, but it is of course a symptom of a potential violation of DRY principle. So let's assume that in this case it is a violation of DRY principle, and let's DRY the code. So what we can do, we have to have a single point of representation, right? So we create a class default flyable, and put the implementation in that class. Now our class, bird and butterfly both have to implement a flyable interface. And essentially in the implementation, we just delegate it to our default flyable implementation, which is pretty much a Java level. However, we just learned we can use at delegate. So let's make use of that feature. Once we are at this level, let's just look at how many parts are there. What are the moving pieces available here? You have an interface declaration, and you have the implementation, and finally you have the delegate part. Let's see, is there any way to simplify this further? That is where great feature of Groovy comes into effect. So instead of my interface, I create a trait here, trait flyable. Within the trait, I can put the implementation also. And my both the classes, bird and butterfly, they implement a flyable trait. With that, the code would be working as expected, but you know, the way things will work under the hood is, you know, a trait will be, when it compiled, it will generate, you know, an interface with the same name, what you give it to trait, the trait flyable becomes now interface under the hood. And there is an implementation is generated, which is not using inheritance. And finally, your class has to implement that interface, and it gets, you know, the code, the call gets delegated to the helper one. So this is a synthetic code, you know, generated by the Groovy compiler. You could use the, you know, EST transformation viewer and get this code. So just a simplified view of that. Now there are cases you may have to make the interface, you know, explicit. For example, say your interface is already defined in some third-party jars, specification jars. That is one of the cases. Or you yourself want to ship that interface as part of a different jar. These are the potential reasons why you know, you may want to do that. The more I see, you know, the Java default methods being used, I start appreciating, you know, the interface more and more, because today I think, you know, the kind of interface meaning has been lost to some extent. The moment I say interface, people think it's okay, Java interface, rather than using it to mean that, okay, it's a contract, right? So now, in such cases, when you have an explicit interface, it's fairly simple. Your trait can implement an interface. The problem is solved for you. And a typical case is like composing, you know, multiple behavior into the class. So a class have two traits here. First one is singer, second one is dancer. So those two capabilities are composed into class actor through trait. In the absence of this composition, ideally you would have ended up, you know, making your super class loaded with you know, plenty of methods, kind of violating interface segregation principle potentially. So now with the composition, you don't have to do that, because these behaviors are defined in their own traits with the, you know, adhering to the single responsibility principle. And whenever you want it to be composed into certain class, that can be done with the, you know, with very, very easy. So having seen how we can compose behavior, let's see how we can compose state. So in this case, I'm creating trait which holds the state, that's a UUID, and I can have classes implementing these traits. In this case, product, you know, implements my trait, that is the business object. So when you create the instance of that, you could use, you know, as if it was right away declared, you know, within your class. But under the hood, you know, this is the synthetic code or the code generated by the compiler. So you see an interface with the name of the trait, and there is an additional interface to store, you know, the state contracts, right? The getter, setter, those kind of thing. And finally, you have the trait helper as usual, and your class, which is product in this case, implements both you know, the trait interface and the interface generated for field. Now, what we have seen is how you can compose something right at the compile time. But is there any option if we want to compose something at runtime without having you know, it defined at you know, compile time? So I have a class called person, and person does not have a fly method. It will not work. So what I do here is I invoke the method board plane. What it does is person, it will apply the trait person dot with traits, and it give the list of traits what are to be applied. The return object now will have the fly method available, and which you can invoke that. So essentially a proxy will be created through which the fly implementation is supplied to you, though the actual type of the object will not be person anymore, because it's a proxy to that. Of course, we have seen how a trait can implement an interface. Now here we can see how a trait can extend from another trait. In this case, I have a trait called Java programmer, which has a method code object oriented, and through this trait, the method code object oriented is available to Groovy programmer trait also. Right, again composing into that. Now Groovy programmer trait on its own defines code functional, and through this ultimately it, these behaviors are available from the class, and within the class I can access these things. Similarly, if you have a trait, extending multiple traits, you could see, REPL, which in that case you have to use implements, you can't use extends. So REPL implements, I can say reader, evaluator, printer. So all read, eval, print methods are composed into REPL, and I can, implement REPL into Groovy REPL, and that's how you could get all those behaviors available to the instance of Groovy REPL object. Well, now it comes to default methods. So right when traits were introduced in Groovy, there were no default methods in Java. However, later default methods were introduced in Java. Now what happens if you create a default method in a Groovy interface, in a Groovy file, right? So I would save this in my interface.groovy, say, and default methods, those will be converted, those will be treated as traits and compiled. So doing this default method is very equivalent to creating a trait and declaring a method in that. That's how it would work in Groovy. If you have a default method in Java, yeah, it would work as usual, because it will be compiled with Java. Yeah, that's how we would do our typical favoring composition with the delegate plus trait. Before doing that, I think there was a question. Are you not doing a multi-inheritance model? I'm not sure. Are you referring to the Java's default method mechanism? That's how. But yeah, the diamond problem kind of thing is very relevant here also. But you could always resolve that using super dot, and you can specify, which, say your class is, implementing two traits, they have the same methods, then you can, resolve which has to be called using super dot, and you could mention the trait name. Yes, if it is already Java, then the Groovy will respect default method of Java. So with that, let's move into function composition, which in case you are doing programming in functional style, then composition works. The only option is, of course, using functions and function composition. So this is the example I showed earlier also, which is like I have a function first names of developers, which takes a list of developers, and finally closure, which filters the needed ones, right? For example, say if you want Groovy, so filter all the Groovy developers from the list of developers, and so that's what happens first, and finally, we from the selected devs, we just perform a map operation and get the name of it. And we could, you know, write similar closures, say Groovy dev selector, Java dev selector, like that. And now what I want is ultimately, you know, a single function, right? Java and Groovy dev selector, which is like composed of, you know, these two closures, right? I need a third closure composed of first two closures. So what I do is the function composition, which is also, you know, available out of the box in Groovy. The order of, you know, the arrow, I mean, that shows the direction. So you take a Java dev selector, output of that is fed to, you know, Groovy dev selector. So what is important to be noted here is like, you know, the output type of Java dev selector should match the input type of, for, you know, Groovy dev selector, which is all list of developers in this case. And that gets passed, you know, as a function higher order to the higher order function first names of dev. Well, these are the, I believe, you know, some of the techniques that helps you to write a better code with the composition. And with that, I believe there should not be any excuse for favoring composition and sticking to, you know, inheritance. Any questions?
Apparently not. Oh yeah, that's the one. Does the trait in Groovy convert the def method? I'm not sure I understand that. Do you?
I'm not sure I understood that question. You can have default methods in Java classes. That's fine. But, you know, Groovy will, in Groovy classes, if you create, rather interfaces, right? If you create default methods, those would be treated as traits rather than plain interfaces. Yeah, so, I mean, it will work, but not as Java default methods, but as Groovy traits. But then, yeah, Java default method will be, you know, it's not a composition technique. It's a pretty much inheritance. So I'm not a fan of, I understand that there are certain cases where default methods are useful. But in my opinion, I have already stated that number one abused feature in object-oriented, let's say Java is inheritance. And I would definitely give number two to default methods because they directly favor inheritance. So that way, I believe you know, default methods have caused more harm than use. And it's also, I believe, it with that what happens is you know, you lose that perspective of what is the contract versus what is the implementation. So you know, when you have a plain interface, say where implementation was not allowed, you just think about contract. Okay, that's the, you know, single responsibility principle, right? The moment you know, it is mixed with the, you know, implementation also, what happens is, okay, you lose that focus, especially in the frameworks these days. What I see is like a lot of there'll be plenty of default methods. I do understand the implementation is required because you believe in convention over configuration. So I believe that default implementation availability is not always default method. That is a clear difference, but unfortunately that thought is becoming less and less. Is there any good practice rules when there is a lot of trades? Yeah, so I think especially one principle you're talking about, is you know, interface segregation principle. Instead of having a very, you know, fat interface with a lot of methods, you could have more focused interface doing, you know, specific things. So again, you know, single responsibility principle comes into picture. Since they're always composable, I would prefer, you know, more, you know, smaller traits doing single responsibility, getting composed into classes. I think that rule helps. So regarding principle, these two, both interface segregation and single responsibility. Okay, what is the strategy for testing traits? I'm not sure if I have a very specific, you know, strategy as such for that.
Yeah.
Is there any specific thing in your mind when you ask that?
No, it's just that we use traits quite a lot in the project that I'm on. And
yeah.
And I've seen various ways of testing traits. One of them is actually implementing the spec as a trait and then just test the methods on that one. Others is making a dummy class and implementing a trait on that. And the final one is simply taking one of the classes that actually implements a trait and test that and test the trait methods with that.
Yeah, right. Yeah, usually I think, you know, most of the times I have been sticking to using the classes. I believe, you know, of course, if there is a trait, obviously somewhere you would end up using that.
And then there's a question of, to me, why I would go towards traits instead of interfaces. If you have common functionality that you need to share between various classes, traits can actually be a very good tool for that.
Traits, you will have implementations, not just the interfaces. So yeah, if you just need the contract, you can have interfaces, but you know, how do you have composable behaviors represented, you know, independently in a modular way? That is when you go for, you know, traits. Of course, when you say traits, there is always some implementation.
Grail 3 is a perfect example of using traits.
Trait is not really abstract based class. That's
I mean in Grails. In Grails, they use traits to composite.
Yeah, right. Grails uses it extensively. You know, I think there was a question on like you know, so trait is an abstract based class. Not really. So trait uses composition. You know, abstract based class will force you to, you know, typically the problem what would happen is you can extend only one class. So you will make the class contract, you know, or the interface more and stuff with more and more methods. You will force fit, you know, you will have both bird and butterfly inherit from a class forcefully. So, which will end up with a very, very, you know, bad design, unmaintainable design. Especially, it will violate interface segregation principle.
Yes, you can make a pig fly.
Right.